गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू. दिस इज 12th क्लास बायोलॉजी चैप्टर 13 ऑर्गेनिजम्स एंड पॉपुलेशन एंड दिस इज लेक्चर नंबर 4 ऑफ दिस चैप्टर. टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट एज पिरामिड्स, पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी, प्रोसेसेस दैट अफेक्ट पॉपुलेशन डेंसिटी एंड एक्सपोनेंशियल ग्रोथ मॉडल. सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद एज पिरामिड. Age pyramid is an attribute of population, right? It is the structure obtained when age distribution is plotted for the population. Age distribution means percent individual of a given age or age group. You can say pre-reproductive age group, reproductive age group or post-reproductive age group. Okay, so that age distribution is plotted for the population and that is called age pyramid. For human population, age pyramids generally show age distribution of males and females in a combined diagram. Okay, no separate diagrams are made for male and female. In a combined diagram, we show all the male and female of a age group. Like in pre-reproductive age group, we will consider all the male and female, and likewise for the reproductive and post-reproductive age also. Right? Now, there are three types of age pyramids for human population. And here in this picture, you can see these three types of age pyramids. These are for human population. So these are expanding type age pyramid, stable age pyramid, and declining age pyramid. Okay. And in these pyramids, you can see these different group age groups are shown. Like on the base, there is pre-reproductive age group for all the age pyramids. After that, in the middle, there is reproductive age group. And after that, on the top, there is post-reproductive age group. Okay. Now, let's start with first type of age pyramid, that is expanding type age pyramid. So, here in expanding type of age pyramid, you can see base is broad. Okay. So, here individuals in pre-reproductive age group are very large in number. Okay. So, pre-reproductive age group individuals are very large in number, while the number of reproductive age group members is moderate, while post-reproductive individuals are fewer. That's why it is making a triangular shape. Okay, so this type of age pyramid is also called triangular shape age pyramid. You can note down all these things. This expanding type age pyramid is also called triangular type of age pyramid, and it is representing expanding population, means population is increasing at a rapid rate. Okay, population is increasing very fast, and such type of age pyramid is shown by Indian population. Okay, India, Brazil, all these countries population show this type of age pyramid. Next type of age pyramid you can see in the middle is stable age pyramid, and here in the stable age pyramid you can see its shape is bell shaped. So it is also called bell shaped age pyramid, and here in this, the number of pre-reproductive and reproductive individuals is almost equal. Okay, you can see this yellow color bar and above that blue color bar. So the number of reproductive age group and the pre-reproductive age group is individuals is almost equal. And after that, post-reproductive individuals are comparatively fewer, right? And it is making a bell-shaped pyramid. This type of pyramid is observed in countries like USA and Denmark, and this is showing the population size remains stable. Okay, stable type of age pyramid is showing that population size remains stable. Next type of age pyramid is declining age pyramid, and it is making a urn shape age pyramid. It is also called. Here the proportion of reproductive age group is higher than individuals in pre-reproductive age group, right? That's why this is declining age group, and it represents declining population, means negative growth in population, right? And such type of age pyramid is observed in countries like Japan. So these are three age pyramids. After that, next attribute of population is population size or population density, that is represented by N. Population density can be represented by N. It is the number of individuals of a species per unit area or volume. like this, we can define the population density. The number of individuals of a species per unit area or volume is called population density, right? For example, population density of Siberian cranes, those are birds you can say, at Bharatpur wetlands in any year is less than 10. It is millions of millions for Chlamydomonas in a pond, right? So this is called population density. Population size is also measured in percent cover or biomass. For example, in an area, 200 Parthenium plants and a huge banyan tree are seen. In such cases, measuring percent cover or biomass is meaningful to show the importance of banyan tree. Okay, in this case, if you will count the number, then Parthenium plants are 200 in number, while banyan tree is only 1 in number. Then what will you say? That population density of Parthenium plant is more than banyan tree? No, because here we will consider the biomass. Okay, it will be like a disrespect for the banyan tree if we will say that its population density is less than Parthenium plants, because its biomass is larger than Parthenium plants, right? That's why in some cases we consider biomass as the population density, right? So in such cases, measuring percent cover or biomass is meaningful to show the importance of banyan tree, or for any population we can consider the biomass, right? So population size or population density can be measured by the number of individuals or by the biomass. This is another method for measuring the population density. So a total number is a difficult measure for a huge population. In such cases, relative population density without knowing absolute population density is used. Okay, so here we use relative population density because we don't know the exact number of individuals in that population. So absolute population density is not known here. That's why relative population density is used, because population is very huge. Okay, for example, the number of fish caught per trap indicates its total population density in the lake. Also, what is done here for measuring the fish population in any lake? We just count the number of fishes in one trap. Okay, and on the basis of that relative population density, we tell about the population density of fishes in that lake, right? And similarly, the population density of bacteria in any cultural plate can be measured with this method, with the relative population density. Next is, in some cases, indirect estimation of population sizes is performed. And for this indirect estimation, what is used? For example, tiger census in national parks and tiger reserves based on pug marks and fecal pellets. So here, you can say footmarks of tiger and fecal pellets of tiger are used to measure the density of tiger, or you can say the number of tigers in any national park and tiger reserves. Our next topic is population growth. The population size changes depending on factors like food availability, predation pressure, and weather. Okay, for these are the factors you can say due to which population size changes. It increases or it decreases, right? Based on these factors. So changes in population density give some idea about the population, whether it is flourishing or declining, right? So if population density is changing, so we can easily tell that this population is flourishing or declining. These are four basic processes that fluctuate the population density. Means because of these processes, population density either increase or decrease. Okay, these are natality, mortality, immigration, and emigration. So first is natality, that is represented by B because it is also called birth rate. So it is represented by B. Natality means the number of births in a population during a given period. After that, mortality, that is called death rate. That's why it is represented by D. And it is the number of deaths in a population during a given period. Next is immigration. Immigration means the number of individuals of the same species that have come into the habitat from elsewhere during a given time period. So if the number of individuals are coming from any other habitat to that habitat, what will happen? That will increase the population. Okay, that is called immigration. Like some individuals are coming from any other habitat to that habitat, that is called immigration during a given time period, right? Emigration is opposite of immigration, and it is represented by E, and it is the number of individuals or population who left the habitat and gone elsewhere during a given time period, right? So these are four basic processes which due to which there is fluctuation in population density. Now, natality means birth rate and immigration, where the individuals are coming from anywhere else in that habitat, okay? So natality and immigration increase the population density, right? Because natality is birth rate, there will be more birth rate, population density will increase. And immigration, if the individuals from any other habitat will come in a particular habitat, there will be increase in population density. So we can say natality and immigration increase the population density, and mortality, that is death rate, and emigration, if some individuals are have left that population and have gone somewhere else, then it is called emigration. So due to that, there will be decrease in population, right? So mortality and emigration decrease the population density. Now, if n is the population density, we know population density is represented by n. So if n is the population density at any time t, then its density at time t plus 1 will be, it will be represented like n t plus 1. N t plus 1 means after the after a particular time period, in a particular time period, you can say, okay, at time t plus 1. So n t plus 1 will be equal to n t, that was population, initial population density, you can say, right? So n t plus b plus I, b plus I is natality plus immigration, okay, minus d plus e, that is death rate, or you can say mortality, plus emigration. So this is the formula for measuring the population density after a time, for a particular time period, okay, how and that how these processes are affecting the population density of any habitat. You can calculate with the help of this formula. Next is, population density increases if b plus i means birth rate plus immigration is more than d plus e. Okay, death rate plus emigration. So, obviously B plus I is more, then the population density will increase, or otherwise it will decrease. With the help of this flowchart, you can understand about these processes. So, in the middle, this blue color box is showing the population size, and here you can see the plus and minus sign for the, like plus sign for the natality and the immigration, means these are responsible for increasing the population size or the population density, okay? And then minus sign is shown for emigration and mortality, it means these are responsible for decreasing the population size or population density. So you need to make this flowchart. Next is, under normal conditions, birth and death are important factors influencing population density, right? Immigration and emigration have importance only under special condition. For example, for a colonizing new habitat, immigration may be more significant to population growth than birth rates. Right? If there is a new habitat, then in that new habitat, some individuals will come from any other habitat, right? So at that time, immigration is more significant, because at that time very less number of individuals are there in that habitat, okay? So birth rate will be not so effective, because very few individuals are there. So birth rate will be negligible, but immigration will be more significant, that how many individuals are moving from any other habitat to that particular habitat, that thing will matter, okay? That's why we can say that immigration and emigration have importance under special condition. Which type of special condition? Like for colonizing a new habitat. At that time, these processes play very important role. our next topic is growth models, and we have two types of growth models: exponential growth model and logistic growth model. So first is about exponential growth model. So first of all, we know that resources like food and space are essential for the unimpeded, means not hindered, population growth, right? If resources are unlimited, each species shows its full innate potential to grow in number, right? If there will be unlimited resources like unlimited food and spaces available, then species will show its full innate potential and will increase in number very fast. So what will happen? The population grows in an exponential or geometric fashion. As you can see here, an example of exponential growth of Paramecium. Like on first day, if we are starting with day 0, okay, there were, means here we are not counting the population growth, okay, only one Paramecium is there, and on day 1 it has become 2 in number. Then on day 2 it has become 4 in number. On day 3, 8. Then day 4, you can see this number increase in this number. It will just double in number. It is increasing at geometric rate. Then on day 5 and day 6. So you can see here, in 6 days, at this with this geometric rate of growth, this Paramecium is showing exponential growth. Now with the help of this graph, you can show exponential growth. Right, on this graph, on one side number of organisms is shown and on one side time is shown, right? And there are only two phases for the exponential growth model. Lag phase means it is the starting phase when any new species colonize and inhabit and starts increasing, increasing its number, okay? So this is called lag phase, means at this time there is slow growth. And after some time, it will show the exponential growth phase. Means it is increasing at very fast rate, right? And because we are saying that resources are unlimited, like food and space is unlimited, then what will happen? This population will show the exponential growth rate, okay? So this exponential growth phase is shown here, right? Do you think this type of growth is possible in nature practically? So this is not possible for the population, because obviously for all the habitats there will be limited food and resources, limited food and space, like there will be limited resources. That's why this exponential growth phase will be possible for some time only. After that, that it will be not possible, right? So you need to make this graph for showing the exponential growth model. Next is, if population size is represented by n, birth rates per capita births, you can say birth rate is represented by b, and death rates, means per capita death, is represented by d, then the increase or decrease in n during a unit time period t will be dn by dt is equal to b minus d, means birth rate minus death rate, into n, that is population size, right? Because here we are taking unit time period, that is d. So with the differentiation we will write dn by dt, and it will be equal birth rate minus death rate into population size, which was initial population size, that is n, right? Here if we consider that b minus d is equal to r, means birth rate minus death rate is equal to r, then we can write it like this, dn by dt is equal to rn. Now what is this r here? This r is intrinsic rate of natural increase, means the rate with which population can increase its size without taking into account any other factor, other environmental factor, okay? If we are considering only birth rate and death rate, so at which rate a population can increase its size, that is called intrinsic rate of natural increase for any population, okay? And this R is very important parameter for assessing the impacts of any biotic or abiotic factor on population growth. If the R will increase, it means population is increasing. Okay, if intrinsic rate of natural increase is increasing, then population size will increase, and if it decreases, population size will decrease. So different R value is given here. Like for Norway rate, this R value is 0.015, for floor beetle 0.12, and for human population in India, it was for 1981, because it can change with the impact of some biotic and abiotic factors, right? So this is 0.0205 in 1981. The integral form of exponential equation is nt. So this is integral form of the you have seen the dn by dt is equal to rn. So this is the integral form for that equation, right? This is nt is equal to n naught ert. Here nt is population density after time t, n naught is initial population density, you can say population density at time 0. R, you know, intrinsic rate of natural increase, and E is the base of natural logarithm, and its value is 2.71828, right? It is the base of natural logarithm. So this equation you need to learn. Now, based on today's topics, your homework is NCERT question number 6 and 18, and also make that graph for exponential growth. Now let's discuss the homework solution of previous lecture. And here first question of NCERT is, how is dipose different from hibernation? So dipose, you know, is a phase of suspended development to deal with undesirable conditions. Here development is suspended, right? Several species of zooplankton and insects display dipose to pass through extreme climatic condition while in their development stage. So development stage gets suspended to cope up with the undesirable conditions, and examples are given here of zooplankton and insects. On the other hand, winter sleep or hibernation is a resting phase wherein animals escape winters by hiding themselves in their shelters. So here the mature animal is showing hibernation. Okay, this any developmental stage is not showing this suspend. This is shown by a mature animal. They do so, means these animals show hibernation, by entering a state of inactivity achieved by decreasing their metabolism. And this process of hibernation is observed in squirrels, bats and some rodents. Next is question number 5 of NCERT, and here you need to list the attributes that populations possess but not individuals. So these are the attributes like natality or birth rate, mortality or death rate, age distribution, sex ratio and population density. These are attributes of population but not of individual. So you can also describe these attributes according to the marks of question. Next is answer for question number 11 of NCERT, and here you need to tell the adaptations of desert plants and animals. So let's see the adaptation in desert plants. About it we have discussed in previous lecture also. So let's see, these plants possess sunken stomata, as you know, on leaf surfaces, and thick cuticle to decrease the transpiration. Next you can take example of Opuntia. Like in Opuntia, leaves are modified to form spines where photosynthesis is performed by green stem. These plants of desert have specialized pathway that is known as crassulation acid metabolism or C4 pathway to manufacture food that facilitates the stomata to stay closed during the day. And if the stomata will remain closed during the day, that will decrease the water loss caused through the transpiration, right? So these are adaptations which are found in desert plants. Next are about the adaptation in animals, and here you can take examples of kangaroo rat, lizards and snakes. Okay, like in kangaroo rat, you know, fat oxidation provides water. Okay, so a kangaroo rat never drink water in its life and has a potential to concentrate its urine to conserve the water. And also you can tell about the fat oxidation, where the water is released as a byproduct. Likewise, you can take example of some snakes and desert lizards, where you know they launch into sun early in the morning and burrow themselves in sand afternoons to escape the heat of day to prevent water loss. Okay, so all these examples you need to write here.